And I remember looking out after the bombing and seeing Manila on fire. It was all around us. And I could hear the patients screaming for help.
So he said, I want each one of you to remember that you are an American. You are an officer in the United States Army.
How could they prepare us? There was no precedent for women, nurses, being taken prisoner.
Life was pretty monotonous. It was a constant struggle from day to day to exist. Food was very scarce.
I went to bed hungry. I got up hungry.
To us, liberation was just around the corner.
Freedom is not free by any manner of means. We've got to fight for it all the time. We have to pay for it.
It's something to be really treasured.
After Japan struck at Pearl Harbor and invaded Guam and the Philippines, 5 Navy nurses on Guam and 11 Navy and 67 Army nurses, 3 Army dietitians, and 1 Army physical therapist in the Philippines were captured and interned. These were the first American women prisoners of war. There were not many Army and Navy nurses in the Philippines in 1940. Only 2 in the small post hospital at Camp John Hay near Baguio. 8 staffed the Fort Mills Hospital on Corregidor. About 20 were assigned to Sternberg General in Manila. 6 or 7 in the station hospital at Fort Stotzenberg near Clark Field. And a dozen Navy nurses on Cavite Naval Base. 5 Navy nurses were stationed at the Naval Hospital on Guam, 1,600 miles to the east. Duty in the tropics consisted of routine nursing duties on wards or in surgery, a busy maternity ward, yet ample free time to enjoy the pleasures and adventures of life overseas. But early in 1941, things began to change as more troops came in from the States. Training stepped up with practice air raid and blackout drills. The nurses' numbers had grown to 105. The possibility of war was on everyone's mind.
The Japs had completely closed off the rest of the Marianas Islands. Even the native people in Guam who had relatives over there couldn't visit them. Well, now, obviously, if they were closed off, that island, there was something going on over there they didn't want anybody to know about.
I was out in the middle of the Pacific in the area of the Marianas Islands. We saw some Japanese ships one day, and we were ordered to put on our brightest clothes, we girls, and go on top deck and play deck games, whereas all the GIs were secreted below and out of sight.
News of Pearl Harbor came as unexpectedly as had the attack.
The commanding officer wanted to see us all. And he told us that, of course, Pearl Harbor had been bombed. I want to tell you something. He said, this is an unusual situation. And we don't know what will ever happen.
So he said,
I want each one of you to remember
that you are an American. You are an officer in the United States Army, and you know what your duty and your responsibility is. He said,
there may come a time
when there is no one to tell you what to do and no one to guide you, But you will know what your conscience says, and you will know the oath you have taken to protect your country. And always remember that.
Later that day, December 8th, across the international dateline, the sounds of Japanese aircraft were heard overhead. The naval hospital on Guam was hit, while in the Philippines, Baguio, Camp John Hay, Fort Stotzenberg, Clark Field, Del Carmen Field, Nichols Field, Cavite, and Corregidor were also struck, and Manila too was bombed.
And with that, we heard this roaring over our heads, and we ran to the door like we always did. We could see the Japanese pilots, actually identifying them as being Japanese. And they flew right over, and they started dropping bombs around everywhere. We evidently lived a charmed life because the bombs fell all around the hospital, but not on it.
Plane fired their load, and one of the corpsmen came through as the plane passed, and he stopped, and from right in front of my foot, he picked up the shell casing. A millimeter difference in the trajectory, and that would have been the end for me. I would never have come back from Guam. It was that close.
The five Navy nurses on Guam were captured on December 10th and imprisoned in Japan until their repatriation the following August. Meanwhile, patients and hundreds of new casualties poured into Manila on crowded trains, in ambulances, trucks, and buses.
And I remember looking out after the bombing and seeing Manila on fire. It was all around us. And I could hear the patients screaming for help. And you wanted to help everyone, but there were only two nurses that were in the ward. And it was a ward that held 78 patients, but they were two and three in a bed. They were sitting on chairs. They were lying on the floor. They were holding on their arms or their legs, or they were trying to control the bleeding. And we received orders from our chief nurse, whatever patients we thought should go to surgery, line them up. And they were operating on the steps. The doctors never changed gowns. And in fact, I went up to the operating room one time to check out, and they were just standing in blood. It was all over the place.
From December 8th until after Christmas, daylight air raids continued without pause, while on Luzon, enemy forces swarmed ashore. In 2 weeks, the Japanese changed this peaceful world into one of confusion, destruction, and death. Medical supplies were shipped to Bataan to support what Generals MacArthur and Wainwright saw as a holding force, a defensive line to be held until a convoy of ships could bring more men, weapons, and supplies from home. Army nurses were ordered to evacuate Manila on December 23rd.
The commanding officer told us we would be going to the field tomorrow, to Bataan. Then this was probably the first time any of us ever heard the word Bataan. On Christmas Eve morning, we were loaded into buses and trucks in our white, crisp uniforms and transported to the peninsula of Bataan.
The next day, Navy nurses moved with their patients to Santa Scholastica, just outside of Manila, and were captured a few days later.
But one thing I remember was looking out over the balcony and seeing the American flag come down and the rising sun going up.
On Christmas Day, Hospital Number 1 went into operation at Lamai on the southeast coast of Bataan. Between then and January 25th, major surgery was performed on more than 1,200 battle casualties.
When Hospital Number 1 at Lamai began to get crowded and casualties continued to come in, it was decided to set up a hospital further down the peninsula. This was designated as Field Hospital Number 2. And as I understand it, they took bulldozers into the jungle and just bulldozed out paths, and cots and beds or whatever was available were set up along these jungle paths. So we started to evacuate patients to that area from Number 1, And each morning, the ward officer and the nurse in charge would go around and decide which patients could be evacuated. And at this point, we were receiving so many casualties and doing so much surgery that oftentimes a patient that had had surgery the day before had to be moved the next day. And these people were put on canvas litters and loaded into buses and trucks and whatever and sent down to Field Hospital Number 2. The girls lived in these buses and they bathed in a stream.
Well, I remember when a new patient came in, all we did was clear a little piece of the ground under the jungle and toss a blanket on the
ground.
That's
right, that's all you could do.
But all you could do was give them a little food and a little medicine.
There's one thing that stands out in my memory that makes me feel very badly. When I was making my rounds through the wards, as I had to do every day, there was one man calling for a drink of water, and I didn't give it to him. Now I wish I had, because poor fellow, wouldn't have done him any harm.
Meanwhile, Lamai was bombed and Hospital Number 1 evacuated to a new site, closer to Marvelous. Its cots set up on the hilltop site of an abandoned motor pool.
There were two wooden buildings. One was turned over and used as the operating rooms. The other wooden building was occupied by us nurses as quarters. But the patients themselves, the casualties themselves, were literally out in the open with only the cover of the overhead jungle growth.
On April 7th, 1942, Hospital Number 1 was bombed. Patients were killed and two nurses were injured. Then the word came to evacuate to Corregidor the following day.
The sad part being there that night was, I think, our soldiers. All our men had been told to retreat. And they came by, and they all stopped and said, "Do you have any food?" Everyone was hungry, and we didn't have any food to give them. We were hungry, too.
The night that we were supposed to leave Bataan, the commanding officer called me down, and he said, "Get your nurses all down here at a certain time and tell them not to bring anything but what they can carry in their own two hands." And I said, "What about my little Filipino nurses?" "They're not going," he said. And I said, "Well, then I'm not going either, because they call me Mama Josie and I'm not going to leave them here." So he got word from headquarters and he called me. He said, "They're going. Get them down here."
The boats carrying the Army nurses crossed the narrow bay to the island fortress while dodging Japanese aircraft. They arrived to find Corregidor already under siege.
If you ever want to know what the darkness of Egypt was like, you would find out in Malenta Tunnel when the bombing would occur and the generators would go off. It would be so dark that you could feel it.
It was all a very gory mess. What was almost worse were the Navy personnel that would get shot up, you know, in the water, covered with oil slick and trying to swim through fire, you know, the oil and the gasoline being on fire. And they would come in as black as could be and trying to clean them up enough to do whatever surgically had to be done was a terrible chore.
Surgical teams worked at times by lantern or flashlight as the bombing shook the rock fortress for 26 days and nights, and the battle for Corregidor continued. More patients arrived to find already overcrowded wards spilling out into the main tunnel.
When I knew that surrender was coming, I felt very shaky, and I was glad that we had the work to do that. Not that I wanted anybody to be wounded, but it kept my thoughts on something besides what was happening outside.
So when General MacArthur and his family were taken off Corregidor, I think this was the first time that I realized that the writing on the wall, that we would eventually have to surrender.
We were on duty in the Malenta Tunnel Hospital when Corregidor was surrendered. We did not see the flag being lowered.
The quartermaster, Major Frank Krawonik, came to my ward about an hour before the surrender, and he had the quartermaster flag with him. He said, "Peggy, will you try to hold on to this flag and get it back to the States if you can?" And I said that I would.
How could they prepare us? There was no precedent for women, nurses, being taken prisoner.
The nurses were afraid of the Japanese, yet they faced them in army coveralls wearing no military insignia, only their Red Cross armbands. The nurses were left alone with their patients, both American and Japanese, while their shrinking stores of food, water, and medical supplies were cut even more. Then, on June 25th, they were moved out of the tunnel to the topside ruins of Fort Mills Hospital. A week later, the Army nurses were marched to the docks to be taken by boat, then by truck to Manila, there to eventually join the captured Navy nurses held since March at Santo Tomas University, now a Japanese internment center.
Well, when the Army nurses came in, they put them in a building that was called Santa Catalina, and they kept them separate from the rest of the internees and also from us.
I always felt the Japanese didn't know how to put women in military, and so they wanted us moved in with the civilian group because a large percentage of that was women and children.
After we were released from Santa Catalina, we moved over to Santo Tomas. This was a civilian internment camp of about 3,000 people. And we were told that we would sort of help take care of this civilian internees.
And when we got to Santo Tomas internment camp, the Japanese put us in one large room and searched all of our belongings. When there were two of them searching the footlocker that I had the flag in, and when they saw the flag, they said, what's this? You know, they weren't speaking English, but they were pointing to the flag and wanting to know what it was. And I pretended that it was a shawl. I just gestured that it was a shawl. And so they still looked concerned and talked between them and still weren't certain that that's what it was, I guess. But I just gestured again that it was a shawl put around my shoulders, and they let me keep it.
And we worked the entire time while we were interned. The life was pretty monotonous. It was a constant struggle from day to day to exist. Food was very scarce.
The Japanese allowed only one American Red Cross package to come into the Santo Tomas camp. That contained 48 pounds of food. Some of it was perishable food, which we ate right away.
In Santo Tomas, everybody was always talking about food. You could hardly talk with anyone for even about 10 minutes without the topic of food coming up in the conversation.
But I went to bed hungry. I got up hungry.
I lost 47 pounds during that time and had quite a bit of trouble with malaria, dysentery, dengue. So we nurses were subject to the same problems as the rest of the prisoners.
But it was sad seeing them die. I was on the men's ward, and I know once we had 7 deaths within 28 hours from starvation there toward the last.
The nurses were hungry for news as well as for food. Word of the battle for Midway, Guadalcanal, and the Marines in the Gilbert Islands was smuggled into the camp by internees who worked outside the walls and from the camp's hidden radio. Then in May 1943, the Japanese decided to open another internment camp at Los Banos, 50 miles away.
The first draft was to be 800 able-bodied men and go up to set up the camp, because I think the Japanese really planned to move all the internees out of the city of Manila.
Well, after we started, the first thing we thought about was to try to get something to eat, and we could see a chicken outside the barbed wire fence. And the only thing we could think about was to try to get that chicken so we could make some stew, something to eat.
But we had a lot of bed bugs that came up to Los Banos with us, because the men had these bahuka beds, the native beds that had little holes in them, and they were just the ideal place for breeding. But the Philippine, we learned the Philippine way of getting rid of them. You put your mattress, your spring outside, and put a little sugar on it and attract the ants. And the ants went into the little holes and ate the bed bugs, and then you put some scalding water or something or beat the ants off, and you get clean bed for a while.
Conditions worsened in Los Banos and Santo Tomas as already scarce food supplies dwindled even more. Arrived with news of the American forces landing on Leyte on October 20th, 1944.
To us, liberation, you see, was just around the corner. We certainly didn't think we were going to spend another Christmas in prison camp.
We had no idea that the 1st Cavalry Division was barreling down on Manila, but we heard a lot of firing about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. We heard guns. I was in someone's shanty on the grounds, and we heard guns firing, and the Japanese had loudspeaker systems all over the grounds, and they ordered everyone to go into the building and stay there and stay away from windows. So we had no idea what was happening. But,
I was on night duty at the time of the rescue, and it was 7 o'clock in the morning when the Japanese were out there doing their calisthenics. They had their bayonets all stacked up in one little pile. The internees were beginning to line up to be counted.
Before we knew it, parachutes opened up, and they dropped into the camp, and they killed all the Japanese guards.
I was downstairs looking, and I heard this heavy roar of motors, wondering what it was. And there were the tanks coming into the first section of the camp. And I understand some of the soldiers were frightened, because here they came in the gates, and there wasn't a soul to be seen, and thought maybe we had been disposed of.
And someone opened the gates, and these tanks rolled up in front of the building. And we still couldn't believe that they were Americans until some of the men jumped out and said, "We're Americans, we're here to liberate you."
I remember when that fella came in, he said to me, "Are you hungry?" And I said, "Do you have anything to eat?" And he brought out a chocolate bar. And I held on, I ate a part of it and saved the rest, because we were always saving food. We never threw anything away. And I still do not throw anything away today.
2 weeks after the Santo Tomas liberation, the nurses at Los Banos were rescued and moved by amphibious half-tracks to the safety of the American lines. Deeply affected by their experiences, and with a renewed understanding of what freedom is.
I never forget coming in. Seeing our country you've ever been away, you know what it is.
And we wondered, how do you make them understand what freedom means?
I think the time, the next time, the greatest appreciation for the Statue of Liberty was on when we steamed into the harbor, and that we were home.
It's something that freedom is not free by any manner of means. We've got to fight for it all the time. We have to pay for it.
I think there's not a day goes by that I'm not eternally grateful for all that we have in this great country of ours.
And I'm glad that I served in the Navy and served my country in that manner.
And it was truly an unusual education. I looked at it as such. It was hard, it was terrible, and many terrible things happened, but I wouldn't trade it for anything.
I would do it all over again.